write that stuff because I mean it. I'm from Arkadelphia, so I'm a South Arkansas boy, and I'm among so many friends tonight. Those that know me well, right at Rotary, I talked about the same thing. I do want to mention, from a serious standpoint, some trends that we, as we step back and look at the state as a whole. Dr. Rankin hit on the population trend, and I always find population numbers very interesting. I followed them during my 10 years in the governor's office, and then when President Bush appointed me to the Delta Regional Authority, I had parts of 8 states, and the parts of those states we had were all parts of those states at the Delta Regional Authority that were losing population. So back in January, the breakdown for the 2010 census came out, and it basically showed me that we now, in a lot of ways, have two different states within a state. 39 counties gained population during the past decade. 36 counties lost population. I mentioned duck hunting in Monroe County. Monroe County in the last 10 years lost 20.5% of its population, more than a fifth, in just the last 10 years. That was the biggest loss. Now compare that to Benton County in northwest Arkansas, which had a 44.3% population increase. Now Monroe County has very little in common with Benton County. They're about as different as two counties within the same state anywhere in this country could possibly be. In fact, I contend they're even in different regions of the country. Monroe County is in the deep south. Benton County is in the Midwest. People argue with me, but I think the south ends somewhere between Little Rock and Bentonville. I'm not sure exactly where. Clarksville, maybe Ozark, but I think you get into the Midwest when you get there. So we have that. Pulaski County, where I now live, remains the state's largest county in terms of population, grew 5.9%. You look around at the Faulkner County, Conway, 31.6%, second highest in the state. Saline County, 28.2% growth. Lonoke County, 29.4% growth. So you see that in those central Arkansas counties, and yet, go just a few miles to the east. Go toward the Delta and the Pine Woods here of South Arkansas and go into Jefferson County and notice an 8.1% population decrease. Saline County and Jefferson County, they've adjoined practically. Saline County grew 28.2, Jefferson lost 8.1. As a city, Pine Bluff lost 10.9% of its population during the decade, falling below the 50,000 mark for the first time since 1960. You go back up in northwest Arkansas, though, Washington County grows 28.8%. Even Sebastian County, despite the loss of a lot of manufacturing jobs during the past decade, grew 9.3%. So once more, 39 counties, generally in the northwest and central part of the state, gain population. 36 counties, and there are exceptions, northeast Arkansas, Craighead gains, Green gains in northeast Arkansas, there are exceptions, but generally, east Arkansas and across south Arkansas, losing population. Now, add to that, and I'm not going to get too heavily into politics tonight. I'm glad we've got some sitting members and former members here. I'm also glad you guys went home so I could get out of the state again. I was, my new job kind of tied me down to the education committees. But if you go back and look at the results of the last election, these two states within a state, the 39 counties that are gaining population, and again, there are exceptions you can draw everywhere, but they are trending more and more Republican. The other 36 counties remain truly democratic. Now, I think this is some cause for concern as we try to operate as one state. If we have two states within a state. Now, here we are in this state within a state that tends to be losing population. How do we, as the Golden Triangle, buck that trend over the next 10 years? Let me tell you what I think the good news is. And I know I probably have an inherent bias, especially since I'm not working in higher education. I'm sitting over here with all these higher educators, and I'm trying not to talk about squirrels and get stuff on my shirt and all. I'm trying to clean up my act now that I'm in higher ed. But I think one reason I am now in that, because in the knowledge-based economy of the 21st century, those places that are education centers that stress education are the places that are going to succeed. When we were at the Delta Regional Authority, 252 counties and parishes, again in parts of eight states that I represented, Boot Hill of Missouri, even up that far, Southern Illinois, Western Kentucky, Western Tennessee, large parts of Arkansas, Louisiana, and Mississippi, the Black Belt, across the middle of Alabama, 252 counties and parishes in parts of eight states. We did a strategic plan for that entire region. And we decided that that region probably, as a region, was not going to grow. What we would have to do, and this is politically shaky, you have to be careful politically here, but what we would have to do is identify what we call critical mass communities within those areas and make sure we focus on those critical mass communities. Now, when you get over into the row crop areas of the Delta, and then many of you understand this, what you're dealing with there especially, although as you get, you know, here in the Pine Woods of South Arkansas, some of that, but more so in the row crop areas, is you had literally hundreds of communities that had sprung up based on a sharecropper and tenant farming system of labor back when it took hundreds and hundreds of people to grow that crop of cotton. Now, there is no economic reason for those communities to continue to exist. So despite the amount of government aid that we might pour into those communities, they aren't going to continue to exist. Because anybody who gets an education is going to leave there because there are not job opportunities there. Those cotton crops can now be raised with two, three, or four people that once took 200, 300, or 400 people. So you've got to focus on the critical mass communities, and one of the ways we defined critical mass community was an institution of higher education. A four-year institution at Magnolia, a two-year institution as we sit here at El Dorado, a two-year institution at East Camden. I think you see where I'm going. The Golden Triangle is actually, because of that and other things, well-positioned to buck the trend that we may see otherwise across South Arkansas and East Arkansas during the next decade. One of the things that really struck me in my years of working for the Delta Regional Authority, and I know I talked about this when I was here at the Rotary Club, but I want to hit on it again, is how many of our southern communities were still stuck in what I refer to as the 1950s and 1960s mode of economic development. What was that? Well, those of you who were around then know what that was, and that was southern communities went to the Northeast, we went to the upper Midwest, and we said, look, we don't have unions down here. We got business here a lot more cheaply than you can in Ohio, than you can in Michigan, than you can in Massachusetts. So bring us your shoe factory. Bring us your cut and sew operation. And a lot of our communities experienced a lot of success drawing those jobs. When I grew up in Arkadelphia, we made work clothes at Oberlin. That later became a Levi's plant and made jeans, and made bras, a Hollywood Bachelorette. Cut and sew operations. Those jobs have been gone for years. I don't believe Levi's plant still sits empty right in the middle of town, and you can drive all over this region of the country and see those places going into town that used to hold the shirt factory or the jean factory or the shoe plant. And the for lease sign's been out there so long that it's even fading now. And yet, when I say communities are stuck in that mode, in too many of our communities, our entire idea of economic development is this. Let's go to the federal government. Let's get a grant. Let's see if maybe we can get a state grant too. Get an EDA grant, a USDA rural development grant. We're going to buy a pasture out here on the edge of town. We're going to run in some new water and sewer lines. We're going to put a nice road in here. We're going to throw up a spec building, and we're going to put a nice brick sign right there by the highway that says County Industrial Park or County Business Park to be a little more modern. And then we say, well, and I'm not talking about anywhere in particular. I mean, I saw this all over the eight states I worked in. These communities would say, why aren't we getting these jobs? We got this nice industrial park out here. We got this nice spec building sitting down here. And in a lot of these communities, I would look around and I wanted to say, do you realize your public school system is horrible? Your hospital's not very good. You don't have housing stock. We were still in that very narrow 1950s mode, even though we're in the 2000s now. We were in that very narrow 1950s mode of industrial development instead of in a 21st century mode of economic and community development. So what I'm saying that you have to do, and I always am careful here because I'm not saying we should stop seeking manufacturing jobs. But what I saw in too many of the communities, in all eight of the states where I worked, were those communities were just hoping that the Acme widget company would drop out of the sky and suddenly bring 500 jobs to town. Those Acme widget companies are becoming increasingly rare. And I would think to myself, how much better off would this community be if it took the effort it was trying to put into attracting the Acme widget company and instead created a quality of life to the effect that that boy or girl out there in the public schools of that community, when he or she graduates from college, or maybe a few years later, let them go see the world. I put in my 4 years in Washington, D.C., and then I came back to Arkansas. But let them see the world. But wouldn't it be nice if we had a nice enough community that that person said, you know, I like where I grew up. I think I'm going to move back there. I think I'm going to raise a family. I'm going to start a business. And they might have two employees the first year. But you know what? Sometimes they take off. And sometimes in 10 years, 20 years, they might have 20 employees. They might even have 200 employees. Think about some of Arkansas's greatest business success stories. Did we talk a Murphy Oil into moving from Houston to El Dorado? No. Homegrown. Did we talk a Walmart into moving from Chicago to Bentonville, Arkansas. No, homegrown. Did we talk to J.B. Hunt into moving from Los Angeles to Lowell? No, it was homegrown. Did we talk to Dillard's into moving from Miami to headquarters in Little Rock? No, it was homegrown. Homegrown entrepreneurs, and yet too many of our communities are not focusing on the quality of life necessary to attract those entrepreneurs. In the 21st century, those communities that offer higher education opportunities, in my mind, and again, I'm biased because I grew up in a college town and loved it, but those that offer a higher education opportunity are going to be the communities that already have a leg up. Community development, not just the old industrial development. What does that mean? Well, we all live, and like I said, I love writing about the history and culture and so forth on my blog. And so we all live in really nice, interesting, historic towns. So do what we're already doing. I tell people all the time, I said, go downtown El Rey, go to the square in Magnolia. You know, focus on historic preservation. Focus on your downtown areas. That is all economic development in this day and time, every bit as much as manufacturing recruitment is. Are your streets clean? Do you have a beautification effort? Is your city practicing rigid code enforcement? No excuses, no leniency. Are you tearing down abandoned houses quickly? Are you removing eyesores? Are you forcing absentee owners to adhere to codes and bringing them to justice when they fail to do so? In my mind, that is all economic and community development in the 21st century, as we try to create that quality of life. I travel a lot in that DRA job. In fact, too much to have two boys at home. I was gone too much my last full year with the DRA. I went back to my calendar just out of curiosity, and I was away from home 110 nights in 2008. But I tell you what I was able to do. In driving around those eight states, I could drive into a community, not always, but usually within the first 15 minutes of just driving around, tell whether that community had it going on or not. I really could. So the look of a place is important. The most important thing, though, and you hear it a lot, so I'm going to tell you what every speaker tells you, but I've come to believe it more than anything. The most important thing, it does come back to education. Let me tell you the good news. We have made tremendous strides compared to where we were in public education from pre-K through the 12th grade over the past 8 years. In November of 2002 is when the Arkansas Supreme Court came down with its ruling in the Lakeview case and said your whole system of public education, your funding system is inadequate, you're not spending enough, and it's inequitable. You're not spending it correctly, and you need to redo it. We dealt with it in the 2003 legislative session. We came back in special session in late 2003, went into 2004. I remember well, Bruce, because we were the only legislature in the country in session between Christmas and New Year's. Check that. Nobody else was that crazy. We were meeting on New Year's Eve in 2003 dealing with Lakeview. Supreme Court said you still hadn't got it right, so we came back and we dealt with it again in 2005. We put a lot of new money in, but more importantly than just new money, we improved standards, we improved accountability, and suddenly we're making real progress. So we are doing better there. With the lottery scholarship, we have opportunities now for more of our students coming out of this system to afford to go on to both two-year and four-year institutions that we have represented here tonight. The next big goal, though, and I know for those of educators sitting in the front, Dr. Rankin, I'm preaching to the choir, the next big goal, though, we've got to retain more of those students, and we've got to get them degrees. Among those 25 and older with a bachelor's degree or higher, we rank above only one state, West Virginia. We can't even say thank God for Mississippi on that one. Used to say on that, we can't do it. They've got a higher percentage than we do for those 25 and older with a bachelor's degree. We've got to change that. Governor Beebe set as a goal in the State of the State address, and I think it's a great goal. By 2025, doubling the number of college graduates in the state of Arkansas. And again, with the three institutions that we see represented here tonight, this area is much better positioned to do that than are a lot of the areas that I used to represent in the Delta. So that, despite the losses in population we're talking about, that I think if we can capitalize it, if we can capture it, that is the bright spot. As Dr. Rankin said, we are a natural resource-based area. And things go in trends, and we hope that the downtrend that has lasted far too long in the forestry industry will turn around. We talk about the oil and gas industry. And things do change. Things do change. I used to like to say at the state capitol, when I worked in the governor's office, it would make me mad sometimes when I would hear legislators from Northwest Arkansas say something to the effect, boy, if we could just get rid of these counties down there and over there in the east and down there in the south, you know, think how much higher we would be in the national rankings. And I thought to myself, don't you imagine 100 years ago when this building was new, the state capitol was new, there were probably, when the political power base of the state was in East Arkansas and South Arkansas, there were probably legislators that were saying, boy, if we could just give Benton County and Washington County away, you can't grow cotton up there. That old land's not any good for anything. It's hilly, it's rocky, you can't raise a crop. And nobody's ever going to get rich raising chickens, are they? So if we could just get rid of those counties, we would be doing so much better. So things move in stages. That said, Ben Johnson, my favorite Arkansas historian, is here tonight. But that said, we are in many parts of this state of 36 counties I was talking about, this state within a state, finding a trend now that has gone on for 60 years. As we saw the mechanization of agriculture, as we saw the mass migration of African Americans out of East Arkansas, out of South Arkansas, to Chicago and Cleveland and Gary, Indiana, and places where they could find jobs. So it's not something that's happened overnight. It's a long-term trend. But it does seem to have sped up some, even in the last 10 years, for a lot of counties, if you look at those figures. And it is if somebody has a giant magnet that is pulling the population of Arkansas from the north and the west, a slow migration. I don't think that necessarily changes in the next 10 years. It certainly doesn't change overnight. What I'm telling you is that I think the Golden Triangle region is positioned with its education institutions, with its leadership, with the focus it's already made on downtowns, with facilities like this, with the Eldorado Promise. I could go on and on to buck that trend. I'm here to tell you, you're up against some long-term trends, but you're doing a lot of things right. So if you had to do a handful of things over the next 10 years, you had to focus on just a few, what would they be? I'd say make your public school system, your systems the best that they can possibly be. Let's make the goal of making them the best in the state. And then capitalize on these institutions of higher education that you have, because it is no longer pre-K through 12, it's pre-K through 14 or pre-K through 16 in the knowledge-based economy of the 21st century. Capitalize on that. You live, as Henry said, as he heard about this area, you do live in an amazingly rich, wonderful area. A rich history, good people, great scenery, amenities that people would give a lot for. There's much to capitalize on, but as we look toward the next census 10 years from now and hope to turn the tide of those population losses, remember, it's going to be more about that holistic form of community and economic development than it is the old way of doing things and simply building that industrial park on the edge of town. Thank you very much for having me tonight.